Good morning.
Never too busy for you, Sharon.
Yeah, this is a really special moment for me and also for all of the students. You know, I'm going to start. This is the third of the summer lecture series in 2022, and this is a hybrid summer internship after a year, last year, a fully hybrid and a cancellation in 2020. And I'm going to start going back to that cancellation. I sent out an email canceling the summer program in 2020, very early in the pandemic, really at the start, before we had much of a sense of where things were going. And I had lots of emails back from really disappointed summer interns. And I've had lots of communication with some of them since then. And I said we were going to do something special when we were able to decide a way forward. And I can't tell you how many dozens said, well, if we could speak to Dr. Fauci, that would be special. So this is me delivering on a promise made at the start of the pandemic. It's
really all right. Wonderful. Sounds good.
Wonderful to have you here. I'm not going to do a long introduction. Just remind everyone who is here that you serve as the chief medical advisor to President Biden, that you have been the director of NIAID for many, many years and through multiple pandemics and really, really important worldwide events. But I wonder if perhaps the most important appointment to you is as chief of the Laboratory of Immunoregulation, where your career started and where you continue to do really impactful research. I will just add that a fourth title for me is that I know Dr. Christine Grady very well, your partner for many, many years. And I think that to me, it's a really important element of who you are that you work with her, one of the leading bioethicists and someone who plays such an important role here. A part of these discussions is a little bit of the mixing of the public face and the personal face. And so I will start with that introduction. I feel that I shouldn't start this discussion, you should. So I'm gonna turn the floor over to you to give you a chance to just make some comments to the students. We have folks here ranging from high school all the way on up to postdoctoral fellows, and it's a national audience, not just our summer interns. We've invited students who have been a part of all of our virtual programming since the start of the pandemic. So with that introduction, thank you for being here, and the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Sharon. I don't want to really take much time in any didactic discussion. I really find that it is much more productive and the students and others enjoy it if we ask questions and have them get the opportunity, because this is supposed to be a fireside chat, not a lecture. So I'm not going to be lecturing to them. But the one comment I can make, which I always do when I put myself in the shoes of the people to whom I am speaking, and I would say, when I was at that stage in my career, there's always a lot of uncertainty as to where you're going, because you have a very long and hopefully productive and happy road ahead. But there's a lot of uncertainty associated with that. And people look at people who've been in the field for a while, like myself, and say, I wonder what it was like when you were in my shoes. And I just want to tell the students and others who are listening that I absolutely was in your shoes. And I remember it almost like it was yesterday. And one of the lessons that I've learned over the years is to keep a completely open mind as to what your interest and your pathway might be. Because my career has been characterized by situations and circumstances that I have found myself in beyond my control that allowed me to snatch the opportunity to pursue something that was of interest to me that I didn't actually plan. Planning is important. You start planning by picking the institution that you're going to train at, picking the field that you want to go into. But my experience over many, many years has been that you are, the younger you are, and the audience that I'm speaking to now is, in the big picture of life, quite a young audience, which is really good news, because that means that you're really, in many respects, pluripotential or even totipotential in what you can and cannot do. And if you leave that as not a source of anxiety, but a source of excitement that there are so many things that you can do. And what you have to do is to find your passion, find what really turns you on, and aim for it and go for it. And know that on the way to what you think that goal may be, that things might change. And that if you leave an open enough mind, all throughout my career, things have changed. Because like I said, if I put myself in your shoes, I started off wanting to be a practicing physician where I grew up in New York City, go to medical school, come back and practice medicine. And then a lot of things happened along the way. My introduction to the field of research, the AIDS epidemic, the whole issue of global health, all of those things were not part of my initial planning, but they became an important part which characterized my career. So bottom line, go with your passion and keep an open mind. So let me stop there, Sharon, and let's talk about things that other people want to talk about.
That's a perfect segue. So you followed your passion, and students would like to know when and how and why you decided to pursue medicine. What was your process of choosing a specialty as you completed medical school? What went into that early part of your career?
Well, my pathway to medicine was maybe a little bit unusual. My training in high school and in college, I went to Jesuit institutions, both in high school in New York City, Regis High School, and then Holy Cross College in Worcester, Massachusetts. And that was very heavily steeped in the classics. So I took a pathway that you wouldn't have predicted is a medical scientific pathway. I, in high school and college, took Greek, Latin, French, and multiple courses in philosophy, from philosophical psychology to metaphysics, to logic, to ethics. Wow. So that was my background. I took enough science to kindle in me what I thought was my, you know, two poles of my interest. One was in human civilization, mankind, the history of humanity, together with the science of biology and chemistry and physics. So I wanted to pick a profession where I was intimately connected with people and human feelings and human experience at the same time that I would utilize what I found to be not only a affinity for, but a liking for science. And to me, the best way to do that was to go into medicine. Because medicine, if you really are talking about medicine in its true sense as a physician, you have to be closely connected with all of the experiences, joy, suffering, birth, death, of the human species, which fascinated me. But I wanted to do that in the setting of something that would be scientific. So I picked medicine. Then once I became involved in medicine, I had thought that my career would be fundamentally taking care of patients full-time, doing teaching in a medical center, and maybe some clinical research. But then, according to what I said in my brief introduction, circumstances came about. I came to the NIH because when I was in medical school, it was in the middle of the Vietnam War, and every person in medicine was drafted, and you would go either to the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, or the Public Health Service. You had to go to one uniform service. I became very interested in infectious diseases because I liked the excitement of it. the definitive nature of it, the fact that you had an etiology that you could address, prevent, and treat. I have a great deal of respect for every other subspecialty, cardiology and endocrinology and neurology, but the thing that really turned me on was the interface between the immune system and infectious diseases. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to take a fellowship, so I came down to the NIH. I did not think I would be committed to research. I thought I would use that as training to come back to New York City and practice medicine. But I found out when I got here for 3 years that not only did I really like the whole excitement of discovery of research, but that I could combine that with clinical medicine and do both. So I expanded my horizon. And rather than thinking about being purely a private practice medical person, I wanted to be a clinical research person. And that's when I decided to come back to the NIH after my medical research, my medical clinical training as a resident and an intern and as a chief resident in medicine, to come back to the NIH full-time as a clinical investigator. And I did that for several years. I mean, a long time ago, from 1972 to 1981. And then another event occurred, which is the reason why whenever I talk to students, I say, expect the unexpected. Along came HIV out of nowhere, a brand new disease, which totally fascinated me. And that's when I decided to devote my entire career to studying HIV, which led to my getting even more interested in global health, which is the reason why I took the job as the director of the Institute. So that's sort of a thumbnail history of how I went from a medical student who wanted to practice medicine to the director of an institute that funds most of the research in infectious diseases and has important implications for global health. A circuitous path.
We always talk to the students about this concept that at the start of our career, we only know what we know. And as we learn about other things, we make big changes, which is really what happened as you were making your transition here to NIH and really getting excited about clinical research. There are a number of questions from folks at the start of their decision-making process about medical school, MD, PhD, a PhD with a focus on patient health and health disparities, really translational outcomes. And just a desire to hear your reflections on how various pathways can prepare individuals. And you've watched lots of people that you've mentored make transitions from various, using various educational paths, and just your thoughts a little bit about MD, PhD, physicians doing research, PhDs doing clinical research.
Yeah, it really is one of those things. What none of the pathways that you mentioned is the wrong pathway, and almost all of them are right. You just need to figure out what's best for you. So let's go through the different pathways. A physician gives you greater flexibility. Either a physician who then goes on to get deeply involved in research through fellowships, or a physician who decides they want to become a PhD and do an MD PhD. If you have a strong affinity to the fundamentals of research and you want to make that an important part of your initial training so that you know for sure you would like very much to do bench research, but you want to do it in a medical setting, then an MD PhD might fit just right for you. But if you are not sure about that commitment to doing fundamental research as part of your medical training, then an MD is a very flexible pathway because, and again, I'm not favoring one or the other. I'm just giving you the pros and cons of each. When I went into medicine, as I described a few moments ago, I really had no burning interest in research. I just wanted to be a physician. Wow. My burning interest in research came during a fellowship. So there was no reason for me to pursue an MD, PhD. But if in medical school, either through an elective or through some mentoring, I decided, you know, I really want to pursue mostly a research career, then I likely would have done an MD, PhD. But my main motivating force was medicine, not necessarily science. Now, one of the great things about the field of science and medicine, whether it is an MD or an MD, PhD, that the capability and the potential to pursue diverse pathways is enormous in a very, very positive way. I mean, you could become a physician or a physician scientist, and you could predominantly do research. You could predominantly see patients. You can do nothing with research or patients and go into public health and pursue epidemiology or pursue policy or pursue media. Or, I mean, it's just amazing when you see physicians. I mean, everybody from my good friend Sanjay Gupta, who's the chief medical correspondent for CNN, who's also a practicing neurosurgeon, to someone who also wants to get involved in policy and does a business administration master's after they go to, it's unbelievable.
It's endless
what you could do. So that's really the fun and the excitement about pursuing a career in the biomedical sciences, because it's everything from taking care of a patient every day to studying malaria in Southern Africa.
Yeah. I want to talk a little bit about taking care of patients. As somebody growing up in science at the start of the AIDS crisis, and somebody who also is a member of the LGBT community, all eyes were really on NIH and the government and the response that we were making in the HIV crisis. You took care of a lot of HIV patients here at NIH. You also really were working with AIDS activists, maybe not at the start in really easy ways, but in really impactful ways over the course of the pandemic. I wonder if you could reflect on that early time during the HIV crisis and how that shaped your view of handling public health crises.
Well, that gets back to the first comments that I made in response to your first question, Sharon, and that is an important part of my identity as a physician was as someone who was intensively interested in the human condition, as much or more than the disease or the microbe or the pathogenic process. And what became clear to me when I began taking care of persons living with HIV, who were fundamentally a disenfranchised group because of the stigma and really the prejudice and disenfranchisement that the LGBT community in general, but specifically men who have sex with men, who were at great risk of getting a disease that no one understood. Because when I got involved in 1981, it didn't even have a name. We were calling it crazy names like gay-related immunodeficiency or gay cancer and crazy things like that, instead of giving it a dignified medical name. And then only after a while did we call it the acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. We didn't have an etiology until 1983, 84, and we certainly didn't have any therapies until well into the late 80s, early 90s. So my experience was dealing with people who, through no fault of their own, were going through a horrible experience of a disease that was killing a substantial proportion of their community. And to me, I had a phenomenal amount of empathy, not only as a physician to try and do something to help them, which was very frustrating because almost all of them were dying, but also the fact that they were looking at the disease in a way that was appropriate to the challenge they were facing. Whereas the scientific community was using what were paradigms that were not applicable to a disease that had no therapy except putting Band-Aids on hemorrhages. No. And the way that the scientific and regulatory community was working to get clinical trials going, to make drugs available to people on a compassionate basis, was very, very rigid. And they had ideas about how they could have input into the decision-making. And believe it or not, things have changed a lot, but back then, both the scientific establishment and the regulatory establishment were very rigid. And they were saying, wait a minute, we're the ones that are dying from this. We would like to have input on the design of clinical trials, on the flexibility of the regulatory process. No one listened to them. But thank goodness for, I don't know what it was, must have been my training, the fact that I was driven by a very strong feeling of empathy towards the gay community, that I started listening to them because they were so frustrated that the authorities were not listening, that they became very iconoclastic, theatrical, and confrontative. And all that did was drive further away the scientific community and the regulatory community. And it was my decision almost 35, 36 years ago, instead of running away from the confrontation, was to listen to what they were saying. And it is somewhat interesting that the room that I'm in right now, sitting in here, was the place that I invited the activists in the late 1980s, 1987, 1988. Instead of shunning them, I invited them into this room and sat down and said, I want to hear what you have to say. And once you listen to what they had to say, they made absolutely perfect sense. Mm-hmm. So I became an advocate for them as opposed to an obstacle to them. And over the years, it went from a confrontative relationship to a partnership to actually very close friendships. Yeah. So that 35 years later, some of my closest friends are the people that were outside the NIH throwing smoke bombs, you know, trying to hang me in effigy and say the government wasn't sensitive to them. Those very people, many of them right now, are literally my closest friends 35 years later.
Yeah. I wonder what lessons you took from the AIDS crisis that you have turned back to and used during this crisis, which again is a crisis of such profound human suffering, right? In a scale that was maybe unimaginable when we were facing this at the start.
Well, it helped me to early on appreciate why we had to move very quickly in developing vaccines, because I learned from the beginning, when you're dealing with a brand new outbreak that you don't know where it's going, assume you are only seeing the tip of the iceberg. Yeah. Because back then, what we didn't appreciate with HIV is that the first patients that I admitted to the NIH in the summer and the fall of 1981, that was 41 years ago, with the first patients I admitted here with my colleagues, Cliff Lane and Henry Mazur and others, we were seeing people who were deathly ill with a median survival of about 10 months. We had no antiviral therapies. We only were able to treat their opportunistic infections. And even that was ineffective because when you have a CD4 count of 4 or 5 instead of 600 and 700, it doesn't matter if you treat an OI because they're going to come back and get another OI, opportunistic infection. So we didn't understand that the hundreds of patients we were seeing who were deathly ill were probably infected for 6, 7, 8 years. And only after that time did they become clinically ill enough to require attention medically. Once the test for infection, the blood test, came about, it became clear that it was horrifying, Sharon, because we were seeing 1/20th, 1/100th of the patients who were really ill. So the lesson I learned is don't underestimate an emerging infection. You may be only seeing the tip of the iceberg. And that's the reason why when we saw the first cases of COVID that were said to be just handfuls of cases in China and likely not transmissible very well, we treated it by developing vaccines literally from the very first day. Like, wait a minute, this could explode right in front of us the same way HIV exploded. And we were right. It exploded even beyond what I would have predicted.
Yeah.
And here we are 2.5 years later, and we're still in the middle of it.
It does seem like many, many of the people around us in the community are done with this, right? The masking is dropped. People testing, thinking carefully before they gather indoors. I mean, really, in many ways, the country and the world has moved on. And what's your thoughts about how, as responsible scientists, how we contribute to keeping folks focused on an end game of safety, right, for the most vulnerable? Yeah.
Well, you say as scientists, Sharon, I look at COVID in two major buckets, the scientific bucket and the public health bucket. Mm-hmm. The scientific bucket has performed very well. I mean, it is extraordinarily unprecedented that you would get a vaccine that was proven to be safe and highly effective within 11 months of identifying a brand new agent. And as you know, we identified it in January of 2020, and vaccines became available at the end of November, the beginning of December of 2020, 11 months later. Never in our wildest dreams could that have been. We have antiviral drugs now. We have Paxlovid. We have good tests. That's what science gave us. Public health gave us the capability of implementing those scientific advances, but we're dealing with an extraordinary situation. We only have 67% of our population vaccinated. We rank somewhere around 50th in the world of vaccinating our populations, even less than some of the developing countries. Of the people who've been vaccinated, only half of them have received their first booster shot. Now, even though when you look at the CDC's map of the green, yellow, and orange zones of dynamics of virus, still you go to an airport or on a plane and almost nobody's wearing a mask.
Yeah.
So it's what you said, that we want to be rid of the virus, but hope is not a strategy. if you want to get rid of the virus, you got to get more people vaccinated, you got to get more people tested, you have to have appropriate utilization of masks. We may be done with SARS-CoV-2, but take a look at what's going on and you realize that SARS-CoV-2 ain't done with us.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
I think that what we're watching unfold is a It should inform graduate school and medical education, other clinical education programs, in that all of us need to learn better ways of communicating with non-scientists, with all of us in some way need to be a public health ambassador, right? We understand the facts. I wonder if you see, you know, if you could recommend changes to curriculum for medical students and graduate students, what you would recommend?
Well, I think, you know, I have always felt this way. I have been put in a position of having to do a lot of science communication. I mean, almost as, you know, it's almost a full-time job in some respects to do that. But I think the art of communication really needs to be taught as a fundamental of science training. Not everybody who's a scientist will be asked to or will want to spend any time communicating, but you should at least be taught the fundamental core principles of communication, because even in the best of circumstances, when you don't have the politicization of science, we have an extra stumbling block now in our world today, is we have the politicization of science, where what explains that the vaccination percentage in the red states is 40% and the vaccination percentage in the blue states is 80%. Yeah. And I mean, it doesn't make any public health sense. That's a political decision. But beyond that, getting beyond the inappropriate politicization of science, is the need to communicate clearly. You know, I have some fundamental rules that I've developed myself. No one taught me that. Is that you have to have precision of thought and economy of expression. You got to know what your audience is, and you got to know what your message is. When you're talking to the general public, don't talk to them like you're talking to the National Academy of Sciences. And when you're talking to the National Academy of Sciences, don't talk to them like you're talking to a high school student. You've got to know what your audience is, and don't ever talk down to the audience, but make sure they understand what you're saying. I always say the most important thing when a scientist talks to an audience is not to impress in the audience how smart you are, but to get them to understand what you're talking about. Because if you give a speech to a general public and 98% of the people say, wow, that guy's probably brilliant, but I didn't understand the word they said, and only 2% will say, wow, I understood what he said, that's much worse than having 98% of the audience saying, you know, I really understood what he said, and have 2% of the audience say, well, that wasn't as sophisticated as I would have liked it to be. Yeah. So getting the people to understand what you're talking about is absolutely critical.
In some ways, it's putting aside some of the training we get for when we go to a national meeting or have our thesis defense, present at grand rounds, right? We're really focused on hitting this level that reflects our training. And I think that what we really need to focus on in talking to the public is connection, right?
Right, absolutely.
One of the things, you know, you talk about scientists communicating to the public. For me, a part of the pandemic has been communicating to family and neighbors. And some of my family comes from a community that really hasn't embraced social distancing. It is really a core value of the religion to gather. There's some distrust of medical communities. And I realize that science wasn't really the answer, that I could say, here's what Dr. Fauci says, here's what the NIH says, here's what the CDC says, but it sort of needed to be, here's what Aunt Sharon says.
Oh, right? Absolutely.
And that also is uncomfortable for scientists, maybe, that personal piece.
Well, you hit on something, Sharon, that has been the hallmark of our outreach to the community. And what you're really describing is the trusted messenger. And that's the reason why I have put a lot of time in dealing with everything from rappers. Who ever knew in my life that I'd be actually become friends with a rapper? I mean, I'm the farthest thing from a rapper that you'll ever want to see. But if you get in a conversation, when they have their blogs and when they have their little online discussions, when they say, you know, I just spoke to Dr. Fauci and I believe that we really should be going ahead and getting our elderly relatives vaccinated because they're the ones that are going to suffer the most. When it comes from a sports figure, a rapper, an entertainer, someone that the community identifies with, or it could be someone who is a member of the clergy or a family physician, mm-hmm. or an elderly person who's respected in the community. I mean, I think I got more people listening to what my message about vaccine was in an interview I gave with Steph Curry, the incredible basketball player for the Golden State Warriors, than 20 lectures I could have given about that. So you're right. You've got to pick out messengers that the community relates to.
And all of us need to be focusing on our communication skills. I think that's probably the biggest take-home message. I want to change directions a little bit. One of the things that we have focused on throughout the pandemic and really predating the pandemic, as we looked at data on anxiety and depression and burnout in biomedical scientists and graduate students and healthcare workers, is a message of finding healthier boundaries, to work really hard, but also to take care of yourself. And I know that the pandemic has been an enormous burden on your shoulders, that you have worked unbelievable hours. And there's a lot of trainees here asking questions about how you take care of yourself and what you do to find perspective in the midst of the many challenges you've faced.
Well, unfortunately, Sharon, I'm not a good example of taking good care of myself. You mentioned in the beginning, my partner, Chris Grady, who has got a real good anchor on reality and works in many respects as hard as anybody, but she, I wouldn't say forces, but she coaxes me into a little bit more balance. And our balance together is fundamentally in the field because we're both athletically inclined. So we do things like putting in at least a few miles, 3 or so miles every day of power walking. I used to run. I used to be a marathon runner and a 10K runner. But right now, at my age, it hurts too much. So right now, I am very compulsive about, no matter whether it's late at night or early in the morning or whenever, is to get out with Chris and just diffuse the stress and the tension by exercising. Back in the early days, the early few months, I didn't do that. I mean, I really wore myself into the ground. I was getting 3 hours of sleep a night, which was crazy. And it was Chris who was essentially grabbed me by the ears and said, "Excuse me, but you better just start getting some sleep and eating a bit. Otherwise, you're going to wear out. This is going to be a marathon, not a sprint." And so that's what I've been doing lately. So I think I have a pretty good balance.
Do you think, you know, it's interesting. I ask that question of a lot of leaders in science, and often the beginning of the answer is, "Oh, I'm not a good role model in that regard." Yet you have run for years. So in many ways, you have found ways to take care of yourself. I know that baseball is probably also a part of your way of disconnecting from work now and again. And are you finding some time this year to follow your teams?
No, I have not, unfortunately. I really feel very badly about that because my day is really completely, you know, from 5:30 a.m. to, you know, I'm sitting in front of my computer looking at the copious emails that come in at 9:30, 10 o'clock. So unfortunately, I love baseball. What I did the other day, which was really fun, is I used to be a pretty good basketball player in high school, and I've never given up my love of basketball. So I went out with my security people, which unfortunately I have to have right now, and shot a few baskets up in the court. And I got to tell you, it was wonderful because it just reminded me of the fun I used to have playing basketball. But I did that, and I thought it was sort of like spruced me up for the next few days. I got so excited about it.
You carry that with you. Let's maybe pause for a moment on that issue of a security detail, not to talk about that per se, but that is a reflection of the politicization of science and a reflection of the hard place our country is in right now. And I wonder if you think there are ways that we will walk back this really intense polarization, or is this the new normal for scientists, and you know that we're going to always be needing to manage the science and the healthcare and the public health in the midst of this intensity and right. lack of calm discourse? Do you think this is a new normal for us?
Well, that, you know, it's interesting. We don't have a lot of time left, but I want to end on this because you just used a word that I have been using in my multiple commencement addresses I've given this year. And we are talking to a young audience, and the answer is in the hands of the people who are on the Zoom right now, because it cannot be the new normal, because what we're seeing that requires my having to have federal agents guarding me because of threats on my life and my security and that of my family is what has been living in a world of untruths and lies, of distortions, of conspiracy theories. And what I've asked young people to do, and I've done it at the college level when I've given commencement addresses, but it's even more relevant at a younger level than that, is please don't accept as normal the normalization of untruths. Push back. When people start saying things that are crazy, don't shrug your shoulders and say, well, that's just the new normal.
No.
We can't accept the new normal to be just driven by obvious distortions of reality. The distortions of reality that led to January 6th, when there are still people who deny that that was not an important assault on our democracy. Yeah. And there's still a lot of people who believe that. That is astounding that we have millions of people to think that that either didn't happen or it wasn't a big deal. So no, we cannot accept this as being a new normal. And as scientists, it is the reason why science is no longer considered what it really is, which is a quest for the truth. So if you're living in a sea of lies, science becomes almost irrelevant. We can't accept that.
Yeah. I wish we could talk for a very long time. There are so many more questions, but I am getting chats from your folks that we should wrap up. We're really deeply grateful for all that you have done for many decades at NIH, for your time during the pandemic, and also that you care so much about training. I've asked you to do many things in the last 2.5 years, and you've said yes every time. And I know that you're busy. So thank you so very much, Tony. I hope the next summer lecture series is in a big auditorium where you will have a chance to get some selfies with some trainees. Thank you so much.
I'd love that. Thank you, Sharon. Good to be with you. Take care.
Take care. For all of you here on the call, please join us at the Graduate and Professional School Fair next week. Please join us at the rest of the summer internship program activities. If you're on the Bethesda campus, I am in Building 2, not every day, but many days. Pop your head in and say hello to the OITE. Thank you all very, very much.